Thank you. Oops. Sorry, in fact, the title there. I'm Eric Madelaine. I'm from INRIA in Sophia Antipolis, France. And this is work mainly from my student, Zhen Hu, from East China Normal University in Shanghai. And he's a local professor in China. First thing I want to set up is what I mean by open system. That may not be the usual term for that. It's very well overloaded. We want to analyze and to model concurrent system that might be both asynchronous, synchronous, communicating, whatever you want, concurrent, and interacting with some processes in their environment. And we want those objects to be composable in the sense that the property we prove about one such open system can be composed and preserved by composition. The framework is something we have been developing for a number of years. That's called Parameterized Networks of Synchronized Automata, and with a very bad abbreviation, PNET, that everybody confuse with PetriNets. It's nothing to do with PetriNets. It's a behavioral model, essentially inspired by work by Wei-Min Lin 30 years ago about the labor transition system with data and assignments. So this is my background for a number of years. And we have been developing this PNET model essentially to describe at a very high level this kind of distributed system communicating. And we have been developing theory and tools to encode and to analyze a quite big system with that. So we were addressing distributed components, communicating components, heterogeneous system, synchronous and asynchronous, with a lot of stuff like group communication, reconfigurations, kind of things. And we were developing a system that would do model checking, equivalence checking for these big things in practice. So the main point you can have there is that does it scale well? Well, somehow it does. We were able to do something that would analyze system equivalent to 10 to the power 80 states. That's the number of particles in the universe, mainly. Of course, we don't enumerate them. We build those things hierarchically, reducing by whatever you can, and so on. And we were executing the model checker, the state generator and the model checker on a very big cluster. Okay, it did work. But it did work for system with a small number of components, well, industrial use case anyway, with very small data domains. I had like half a dozen variables, and I would set the domain three possible values for those variables. So this is not what you want as a scalable system somehow. So at that point, we decided to go compositional and symbolic, so to be able to analyze directly first order system with data and to be able to analyze directly these open systems. So that's why we have been developing this open PNET stuff. The idea being that we want to be able to analyze distributed algorithm, parallel skeletons, off-the-shelf components where you have proof properties and you can assemble while preserving these properties. Well, Wei-Min Lin did the same thing in the beginning of the 90s. He was with people in Bristol, I guess, at that time. But it did not really hit the market at that time, essentially because the reasoning methods they had 30 years ago, Tableau method or this kind of things, would not go in practice into systems. Well, there is something very new now, that is we have nice solvers, typically SMT, that everybody is using inside their things. And we will be combining here a finite representation with finite algorithm and deductive reasoning with SMT. And you see that it gives quite good results. So I will give you a short, not too technical description of my PNet formalism and their semantics that I call open automata. I will show you shortly how to define equivalences on these systems. And then the main work here is to propose a number of algorithms that can be implemented in practice. So in one slide, the PNet model is something where you have automata, well, labeled transition system, strictly, where the actions here are expressions with variables. So I keep everything symbolic at that level. And this one is very simple, but you can have state variables in your automata, some kind of finite state automata, and guards and whatever you want. So you deal with data as first order entities. And then you construct hierarchically these things with only one synchronization device that we call the PNet node. So PNet node has a number of subtrees there. Some of them are PLTSs, this parameterized labeled transition system. Some of them are holes, representing the environment processes. And then the synchronization device is something that is encoded as a set of vectors that are symbolic themselves. So the semantic of that is the first subcomponent here will do some actions. The second is idle. So the next one is doing another action. And the semantics globally is unification. And then you will generate this action here that will be visible at the next level. And that's it. So label transition system, one very powerful synchronization artifact with which we can encode mostly everything that you see in standard language, distributed languages or process algebras. And then one composition operator that is, well, just replace one of the holes here by another PNet. These things have semantics, behavioral semantics that we call open automata. So they are finite, well, in practice, in the tools, they will be finite structures with open transitions. And an open transition is like this thing from a global state of the open automaton S to S prime. You do some action. This is an action expression, again, symbolic with variables. And on top in the hypothesis there, you express the behaviors of the holes, P, so like another expression here, beta P, and the predicate that is relating the behavior of these processes in the environment with the resulting behavior. And then you have a post-assignment that will eventually modify the state variables of your system. So essentially, this is using translating PNets into open automata and computing the semantics is using SOS style behavior rules. And we have an algorithm and we have tools to compute that. So I have a running example here that's going to enable everybody knows about Lotus, maybe not, I guess that's old. So the rough idea, it's kind of sequence operator, P enable Q, but dealing with data transmission. So P can do something, some action A, if it's not a delta, that is a termination, a special action of Lotus, and then the enable expression will do the same A. But if P is doing a delta with some argument, then Q will accept this argument as an input, and after that, only Q will be able to work. So that is the sequence operator of Lotus. And on that slide, I have the PNet representing this P enable Q. And I have the open automaton that is its semantics. So here, there is something we call the controller, so a label transition system. And in the synchronization vectors that are encoding here, you could recognize the two semantic rules I had on the previous slide. I don't want to go into the details, don't have time. And this is somehow flattened in the shape of this open automaton. And the three open transitions here are encoding more or less the same thing. So if P is doing some action with some predicate there, guard, then the full system will do the same action, staying in the state as zero here, and so on. Okay? So on top, you have the behavior of holes, and in the predicate, you compute somehow the result in a symbolic way. There is another way to encode an able with the same pinet formalism, and if I'm using data oriented for the controller rather than state oriented in the previous slide. So here I have a state variable as zero, that is zero at the beginning, and while p is working, it's a zero, and when you get a delta, you assign a zero to one, and okay, you are done. So you can imagine there is no suspense here, that these two are by simulation equivalent, and we will prove it at the end. So these open automata, somehow they are flattening the structure of the pnet, and they are abstracting from the implementation features that we have. I mean, the controllers, the variable, are not represented here. So you will be able to prove that the specification is equivalent to some implementation with a very different structure. That's the main goal we have here. Well, we can do model checking also. So let's see what is the equivalent that we are using there. Well, it looks like a bisimulation diagram like in Milner's book or so. S and T are equivalent if for each transition here you have a corresponding transition on the right and vice versa. Only that this transition represents a full set of instantiation of the symbolic action that you have here. So if you think about that as sets, well, you can imagine that to correspond to that set, you can have several differently organized smaller sets that will cover the first one. But you also have variables everywhere. So this state might be related to that one with some conditions on the state variables, and this is what we have in this predicate besides here. So these two states are bisimilar. If by this transition we get a state S prime, and here you have corresponding transition going to states that are related in the same R relation with some corresponding predicates there that are in R. And this set of predicates covers that one in a logical way. On our running example, well, you have those two open automata here, and you see this one has two states, and you have to relate that with only one there. So the corresponding predicates will be okay. This one is equivalent to that one if S is zero, and here if S is one. That's easy. And then you have to relate, You have to relate each transition, so that one typically corresponds to this, even if it has a very different form of the predicates. And that one to that one here. Okay, we proved in a Forte paper 3 years ago that if you start from a pinet reasonable hypothesis, then you get a finite open automaton. And this is an equivalence that was a bit complicated to prove, especially transitivity. And it's decidable whenever inclusion of predicates are decidable. And then you have this very important congruence theorem that says that you can replace pinets by equivalent pinets as you want, which any way you want. There. So that was the main result. I mean, if you prove some property, being temporal logic or being equivalence properties, then by composition of pinets, you keep these properties. Okay, but now we had to implement that stuff. And when implementing that stuff, we run into a problem that this definition I just show you is very sensible to alpha conversion because if you don't have the same three variables, perfect, then you will have difficulties to prove the inclusion of predicates. So we define another version of the semantics where the open automata are closed under substitution and under specialization of predicates that will deal with this problem with variables. We had also to change a little the definition of the bisimulation itself. I will not show that, it's in the paper. and we define an expansion function from a finite automaton computing from a pnet that would define this infinite structure that is a real semantic sphere. So that's what happened here. You have two pnets, you construct the semantics, A1, A2, and for this to be structurally equivalent, well, you build the expansion, the finite, infinite version closed under substitution, and this has to be FH by simulation. Oh, by the way, FH, I did not explain. This is for formal hypothesis by simulation, and this word was coming from algebra processes from someone called Robert de Simon in the 80s. So that's I recovered that name. That was interesting there. So this diagram commutes. We proved that in this paper, meaning you can work on the finite structure generated from the pnet and get the theoretical FH by simulation. Now I will present two algorithms for that. Why is it? Well, essentially because the naive algorithm, check whether a given relation is a bisimulation, requires that you guess what the predicates are in these triples. So for the user to set up all the full relation, giving the triples and the predicates might not be very nice. But anyway, this was the first one we did, and this is the only one that is implemented for now. And the next one will be on the fly and try to generate the predicates when traversing the system. So let's back to our running case. So we only have two triples here, S0 for state-based and D0 for database versions, with this variable equal to 0, and S1 with D0 in the other case. And this algorithm will just traverse all those triples, generating proof obligation for the coverage of the predicates between the transitions, and prove that they are valid, that they are tautologies, and you have details on the algorithm in the paper. Well, you can imagine easily that when you do that thing, you need to prove that if you have this here with the correct predicate on the variable S0, then you will be able to prove that, and vice versa. Okay? So just the most technical slide there. Technically, when you generate these proof obligations, you have this kind of nice formula, and you need to prove that with these two predicates, you can infer that thing that is dealing with the target states in the bisimulation, and the instantiation for the previous running example is like that. And typically, you see that one is coming from the predicate in the transition, and this one is going from the predicate between in the triple there, and blah blah. And we use Z3 to prove these things are tautologies, meaning to prove that their negation is not satisfiable. Well, when it works, we have this correctness and termination theorem. So this checking algorithm terminates with a definite result, true or false, provided that the SMT calls succeed. But people working with SMT know that this will not always be the case, and there are many cases in which your theory might not be complete, and especially if, three slides, that's okay. Especially if you have theories that are corresponding to user-defined structures, I mean, typically Java classes that you want to axiomatize into your Z3 theories. So typically on recursive defined data types or on formula with quantifiers over unspecified function, this will not terminate or not be decidable. It can answer unknown. So that was the result with this first algorithm, and we now have an implementation working for that. The second one is on the fly. So the idea here is that you want to start with a pair of states and then you will traverse all your the product of your two automata, and in a backward way, you will generate all the proof obligation for these two initial states to be equivalent. Okay, and at some point on the way, there may be loops. I will show that in the next slide, and you will have to refine the predicates in the triple and be sure that this thing terminates. So when it works, well, if the two open automata and data domain are finite, we have proved that this algorithm terminates, and it is correct and complete whenever the SMT calls succeed as usual. Moreover, the triple list that we generate is the weakest by simulation between these two states. So just one idea of why you need refinement. In this diagram, this predicate here depends on those, well, depends the way that if to prove this obligation here, this one, you need to prove that this is true depending under that hypothesis. So if you strengthen that one, you will need to modify this one also. So the main key in this algorithm is the refinement of predicates. And typically, it will happen when you have a loop with assignments on the state variables. And this may not terminate because the conditions will increase. I mean, the predicates that we generate, the formula we generate may increase infinitely. And the main version that, well, trivial sufficient condition for termination is finite data domains. And in practice, the way to get finite data domains is to use abstract interpretation. Okay, so that's my conclusion. So I don't go over what I have done, that's easy, but what we are doing now, we are implementing this on the fly algorithm. So the main thing that can be interesting technically for software engineers is how can you integrate an abstract interpretation framework in this kind of algorithm? How can you look at these series of formulas that we generate and decide when you can generalize such a formula? About undecidability of the SMT, well, there is no magic. If you have recursive data types with uninterpreted function, typically you are in a bad situation. So, okay, you may be very careful, axiomatize your theory, or you may try to use something that is not the classical Z3 SMT solver, but you can combine them with some kind of automatic theorem proving stuff. I mean, Isabel H. Hoyle has some automatic decision procedure for all the kind of types and this kind of things. And very importantly, you need to deal with weak equivalences and also model checking, and we are doing that. Thank you.
One question. So all of your conditions about being closed on the substitution and so on, that feels very nominal techniques. Like, have you looked at connections to that body of work? And I mean, it looks like it's going to be reformulating the same amount of mathematical content, but it might be giving you ways of structuring it inside a system and so on.
Yeah, well, the main thing is that we did not foresee that. Yeah. Okay, no problem. We had a paper with these results that were incorrect at the beginning. Well, at least they were not incorrect, but they were not implementable. So just when trying to do the real work, we ran into that. But yes, indeed, the infinite version is much easier to deal with at math level. So it's not only alpha conversion that we do in this predicates.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, I think there are, and looking in the detail of the proof, you can see these kind of things. Yes.